thing I know, America had a chance in 2012 to see whether they agreed with Barack or not. And America voted in president for the second time. And I'm not going to sit still and let these devils in Congress take what I work for, take what my parents work for, take what they die for. They're not going to impeach the president. They're not going to stop him. They're refusing. I'm concerned because black folk are too quiet, you're too peaceful, you're too calm, you act like you don't know what time it is. Somebody called you out your name, you want to turn around and look at who said it. They're trying to say well, they're against his policies. Which policy are you against? Everybody having health care, that's a good thing. Immigration policy that's fair, that's a good thing. Respecting everybody no matter who they are, that's a good thing. So what are you upset about? It must be his look and not his books. I come out and tell you, I was born that night, but I wasn't here last night. So my brothers and sisters, I came to lift up to you from the word of God. When Moses was given the directive by God to go to the Red Sea, Moses said, who shall I say sent me? And God said, tell them I am sent you. If they don't know who I am, is tell them I am that I am sent you. Moses got into the Red Sea and had the rod in his hand. And them same stiff-necked people got crying and complaining, the Lord got them out of slavery. He got them down through the wilderness. Got them to the sea. And they said, oh, you should have let us die in slavery. Then Moses got upset and said, God, what am I going to do with these complaining people? And the Lord said to Moses, shut up. Use what you got in your hand. So God said to us, shut up. Use what you got in your hand. Said Moses got them to the promised land, sent them to take a look. 12 went to take a look. 10 came back and gave a bad report. But one named Joshua and one named Caleb stood up and said, we shall overcome. And they pressed their way to the promised land. Then they crossed over Jordan. And when they got to the river, Joshua said, Lord, I don't know how we're going to cross the river. And God said, the same way you crossed the sea, by my hand. And so God made the water stand up like a heap, the word says. And they walked across Jordan on dry land. And then when they got there, the Lord told them, walk around the wall of Jericho. Do what I tell you to do. If you follow my direction and show courage and show faith, I will move every mountain for you. And God told him, walk around 7 times. And on the 7th time, just holler. Sometimes you don't know why the Lord tell you to holler, but holler anyhow. And so God told him to holler, and they hollered. And when they got through hollering, the wall came tumbling down. But then they got the big head. They started moving without God. And so they went up against Ai. And they lost. They got whipped. So Joshua got on his knees, on his face, and prayed to God, Lord, why did you bring us out here? Why did you let us get defeated? And God said to him in the 7th chapter of the book of Joshua, get up off your face. Stop praying. You know what your problem is. I told you not to take anything from the enemy and bring it back to my people. I told you leave everything that the enemy has where it is. Destroy all of it. Bring none of it back. And the word said that one in the camp brought some things back from the enemy. And God let them get destroyed. I come by to tell you, sisters and brothers, we need a paradigm shift. Paradigm shift is a noun, came originally in the 70s. It used in writing and simply mean a fundamental change in approach or underlying assumptions. What do I mean by that? Joshua was confronted with a paradigm shift problem. They had been disobedient to God. And so they brought some things into the camp from the enemy. Brothers and sisters, the Lord has brought us a mighty long way. If you were to tell the truth, there are people in their grave 50 years ago wouldn't believe you'd be at the Grand Hyatt today. The people in their graves wouldn't believe that the concierge is black and the bellman is white. They wouldn't believe that. The people in their graves who wouldn't believe you could walk around with a suit named St. John and doesn't talk about the Bible, they wouldn't believe that. But here you are, the richest black folk on the planet. The most educated black folk on the planet. And somebody's trying to steal the rights that folk died for, that folk marched for, that folk bled for. And you sit there quiet as a church mouse and let them try to steal what was paid for by blood. The right to vote is precious because it was bought by blood. It's powerful because it can change America without firing a shot. It is personal because it belongs to you. And how will you let somebody take what was earned by blood without a struggle, without a fight? We need a paradigm shift. What do I mean? We have taken some things from the enemy and we brought it back to our house. What do you mean, Reverend? Well, you took arrogance from the enemy and you brought it back to our house. You took apathy from the enemy and you brought it back to our house. You took ignorance from the enemy and you brought it back to our house. You took greed from the enemy and you brought it back to our house. You took hopelessness from the enemy and you brought it back to our house. Where did we hopeless black folk come from? Where did these faithless black folk come from? Where did these pointless black folk come from? How could you come this far in the land that hated you, where you used to be slaves, now you're the president? How could you go back to where you came from? How can you let them push you back? Israel has sinned, that you have some things among you that you must get rid of. He told Joshua, call the camp together. And everybody in the camp who's brought back the stolen things must be destroyed. And Joshua knew that it was on them to straighten it out. Brothers and sisters, in Alabama, in 2010, 386,559 black folk who were registered did not vote. In Florida, 1,011,500 black folk who were registered did not vote. Right here in Georgia, 919,332 black folk who were registered did not vote. In Louisiana, 510,110 black people who were registered did not vote. In Mississippi, 558,170 blacks who were registered did not vote. 819,000 in North Carolina, 262,000 in Ohio, 455,000 in South Carolina, my home state, 355,000 in Texas, 354,000 in Virginia, Brother Brown. That means that we're not talking about folk who did not register. We're talking about those who were registered who did not vote. I don't know about your state, but in South Carolina, my governor in 2010 won by 59,000 votes. 455,000 black folk who registered did not vote. Yes, I can complain about the Tea Party. They are racist and mean. But they didn't stop me from voting. They're trying to stop me from voting. I can complain about the Republican Party. There are a lot of them who are racist and mean. But they didn't stop me from voting.
All right.
So why are we complaining about all the stuff that folk are doing to us? We need a paradigm shift, because we got to start looking ourselves in the mirror and answering the question. Some of you didn't vote in the last election. Some folk who live in your house didn't vote in the last election. Some of the folk, even when Barack Obama won by historic black turnout, hundreds of millions of black folk still didn't vote. This has to change, and it must change this year, this election, is more than about Barack Obama. Affordable health care has changed the game. Folk who never had insurance have it now. Folk who could never be healthy have a chance now. We have a chance to change the direction of the country. They're trying to steal the right to vote in broad daylight. It takes a special kind of robber to steal in broad daylight. But you can see them. When you see them moving, these are bodacious, audacious thieves. They steal in broad daylight. While you're watching, and the thing about daylight theft is you got a chance to stop the stealing if you got the courage to stop the thief before they get to your goods. So you have a chance to stop them in daylight, but you act like it's nighttime. Why are we partying hardy over here and they raising hell over there? Why are you so drunk on cognac when you want to be talking about how you in this mess you in? You got to figure this out. If you don't vote, you're voting yourself back into slavery. These folks plan to send you back. Pay attention to what they're telling you. They are not happy that you got what you got. They're upset that the president is black and they don't plan to let you forget it. Praise be to God. In 1964, I could not vote. In 1963, I couldn't sit in the Hyatt. But oh, look at me now. Pay attention to what's going on. I can vote and I will vote. I can sleep in the Hyatt and I will. And I can pay when I check out. And I can go to the next hotel and check in over there. How did things change? Somebody died. You didn't get born staying in the Hyatt. You didn't get born being good looking and being able to get into school. Now you can send your child anywhere you want them to go. They didn't wake up and change their mind. Somebody died for this. Somebody marched for this. Somebody protested for this. The audacity of you to stand and be so ungrateful. You want to rise up. You want to rise up.
Selfishness and greed are the order of the day. But the church, the black church, Dr. King said, so often I've been disappointed because we've not received the cooperation of the church. So often the church in our struggle have been a taillight instead of a headlight. The time has come for the church, particularly the black church, to rise up and become the headlight. We are still the largest piece of property that black folk own in America. Amen. We still have the freest leadership. Pastors, preachers, prophets, apostles, bishops, and proclaimers are paid for by us. We pay them. And they ought to know who they should serve. And when racism, evil comes to snatch the right of the people, when the police chokehold us, when folks steal what was earned by blood, if nobody says a word, the church and the preachers must speak up. We will be indicted by God Himself. God told Isaiah, speak truth to my people. Go tell the evil that they're evil. And where do we get all the scary preachers from? Every January, we have Dr. King's holiday, and folk quote him and talk about him. But it's one thing to talk King, it's another thing to be like King. And the chance for us is present now. We have an opportunity that is pregnant with possibilities. We can change America. This is our season. This is our chance. This is what we died for. This is what the elders marched for. This is what they prayed for. This is what they did when they washed and scrubbed those floors until their knees ran red with the blood. This is what they did when they couldn't read their own names in boxcar letters. They've been waiting on this generation, this group of people, and here we are. Spending our time partying on our way to hell. The truth of the matter is that we need to stand up and step up and tell the right-wing racists who are trying to steal our rights, not on my watch, not on my time. And if you're going to do it, you're going to go to my dead body, because before I'll be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free. I leave you with this, my brothers and sisters, as we move with Reverend Al Sharpton. Reverend Al Sharpton is the go-to black man, they call him, because he ain't scared. He says it any way he is. It doesn't matter the audience or the season. He don't pick him right now. About right now, he's meeting with Barack Obama. He's the same in that meeting as he is on the radio. He speaks the same time, the same walk, and the same talk. He doesn't back up, doesn't back down, doesn't take an act of Congress to get him to go somewhere. And because of that, he has put himself in a position where he can speak truth to power on television every afternoon. They can't monitor what he says. They can't censor what he says, because he knows if they're fired, I can go back to where I came from, the streets of New York. Every Saturday, he meets with the people in the community. He's not the kind of leader you got to look up and see. You can walk to that meeting in Harlem. You can walk up after the program, shake his hand, talk to him, and tell him how you feel. He's still a Reverend now. Why is that so important? The church, you can't be so far from the folk that they got to kiss your ring, go to all these adages, all this armor God you got, armor bearers you got. Really, you armor bearer, what armor you got to bear? The fact of the matter is, you ain't nothing but a servant, and servants are supposed to be down here with the people. You can't be so high, we can't touch you. You gotta kiss your ring from afar. Where did this mess come from? It must have come from man, it come from God. God said, if you serve him, you must come where the people are. You cannot be too big for that lie, because we come from the little servant. His name is Jesus. He walked with you. He talked with you. He called everybody his own. And you serve him, but you too good for the people out of there. This mess comes from, but somebody ought to stop the mess. We're worried now. But I want to leave you with the prophet who followed the father Elijah. Name was Elisha. Elisha in the 2 Kings, the 6th chapter. Elisha had vision from God. Elisha would tell the king of Israel everything that the king of Aram was going to do. And every time the king of Aram was plotting to destroy Israel, Elisha was given a word from God. But just having a vision from God is not enough. You have to have the courage to say what the Lord told you to say. And so Elisha says that I'm going to speak truth no matter what the king does. And the king put out a contract on Elisha and said, I got to get him. And so the king sent down to Dothan. Elijah went down to Dothan, had a servant, and the servant slept one night. And sometimes your members get worried, pastors. Sometimes your members get worried about what you're doing when you're standing up for what's right. They think somebody's going to bring you down. And the servant dreamed that night that they were surrounded by the armies of King Aram. And when Elijah woke up and went to talk to the servant, he said, son, I want you to understand that yes, there's a lot of the army of the enemy out there. But he said, don't be afraid. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. In other words, there's a host around in the room. You can't see them, but they're right there. There's a big army of God's people, and they're right there. Why? There's more of us than there are with them. I come out and tell you else, but don't you worry about what it looks like. There's more with us than there are with them. They might look like they're winning now, but this is a short season. There's more of us than there are with them. How did I know? How did you get here?
How did you give? How did you become the least, the last, and the left out, and now you're running and moving things? How could it happen? Because they are more with us than they are with them. Or they look like they're winning now. But I got news for you. Look like Moses was a loser, but didn't he win? Because he had more with him than he had against him. Look like Joshua was going to lose, but didn't he win? Because he had more with him than against him. Deborah looked like she was going to lose, but didn't she win? She had more with her than she had against him. Esther looked like she was going to lose, but didn't she win? She had more with him than she had against her. Don't you know, even at the time when Jesus walked up Golgotha's hill, looked like he was going to lose, but he had more with him than against him. When Pilate said, how could you let yourself be destroyed? He said, you don't understand. You're not taking me. If I wanted to, I'd call my daddy. And my daddy said, a million angels.